11. We better get going. Karen? Karen?
What happened? Why, at the age of 32, was this smooth-voiced girl from Downey, California, who led a raucous nation smoothly into the 70s, found dead in her parents' home? Let's go back. Back to Southern California, where Karen and Richard grew up. Back to the home in Downey where their parents still live today.
Long ago, and oh so far away, I fell in love with you before the second show. It's just the radio.
Now, Richard, I'm not trying to criticize. You know, we love your music. All I'm saying is that it needs more...
More punch.
Exactly, to break in. What you need is a singer.
Mother, I can't sing and play keys and lead a band all at the same...
Shh. What is that? Is that Karen? It is Karen. Richard, I think we just found you your singer.
And lost me my drum.
Yeah. Was that you just now singing?
Sorry, too loud?
No.
Mom thinks that you should sing lead.
What? No way.
Never fall in love again. Oh, I'll never fall in love again.
Who else has heard this tape?
RCA? Columbia, Decca.
And they all turned you down?
They said it wouldn't sell.
That hard rock's in.
And wholesome's out.
What's your name?
Me? Karen.
Karen. I like your voice. Tell you the truth, I think you kids have really got something here. Karen and Richard Carpenter. Just a couple of kids next door. Now listen to me. You kids are young, fresh, and it'll just be up to me to make young and fresh a happening thing. I know it's a rough road out there and the stakes are high, but don't you worry. We're a real family here at A&M. We'll take real good care of you. All you have to do is put yourself in my hands.
Special treat tonight. It's my pleasure to introduce to you the Carpenters.
We've only just begun to live, white lace and promises, a kiss for luck and we're on our where there's room to grow. And yes, we've just begun.
The year is 1970, and suddenly the nation finds itself asking the question, what if, instead of the riots and assassinations, the protests and the drugs, instead of the angry words and hard rock sounds, we were to hear something soft and smooth, and see something of wholesomeness and easy-handed faith? This was the year that put the song onto the charts that made the Carpenters a household word.
Cut. Stop the tape. Karen, are you all right?
I'm sorry, Richard. God damn, I'm really flubbing it up today, aren't I? I'm sorry, guys.
Don't worry about it,
it's okay.
I don't know what's the matter with me.
Just relax. Take a deep breath. Look, we'll just do it until it's right. You just do what I tell you and it'll be great.
Well, I just want it to be perfect. Why do stars
time you walk by, just like me, belong to thee, close to you. On the day that you were born, the angels got together and decided to create a dream come true.
Can't hear myself think. Now, where was I? Waist, 28. Thighs, 20.
Why do you need thighs?
For the pantsuit, the hip hugger.
I thought we decided against the hip hugger.
The pantsuit's adorable. You can't just wear long dresses, Karen. I don't care what you read about the midi or the maxi.
I will not wear that hip hugger thing, Mother. It makes me look really fat.
Oh, fat. I swear, ever since that stupid columnist called you party or something.
He called me chubby.
Whatever, chubby. You have just been so fanatical about your weight. I mean, that thing really went to your head.
Oh, it did not. I just want to start watching what I eat.
Karen, you lost plenty of weight on that Stillman diet, and you look just fine now, all right? Now, that's all I want to hear on the subject. You just concentrate on your career.
That's what I am doing, but you gotta look good in my career.
Karen, you'll never guess. Jack's taking us out for a huge celebration dinner in your honor. It's smorgasbord at Scandia.
Oh, my.
What do you say to that?
Eventually destroyed Karen Carpenter is one that plagues many, many young women like her. The name of this private obsession? Anorexia nervosa.
What is anorexia nervosa?
Anorexia nervosa is a condition of self-starvation which affects mostly women in their adolescence or young adulthood. Sufferers desperately want to be thin and often transform their bodies to such an extent that menstruation ceases and they revert to a prepubescent stage.
Do anorexics ever get hungry?
The term anorexia means lack of appetite, yet those who suffer from it are obsessed with food and its preparation while they deny their own hunger and their body's need for nutrients.
Do they really think they look attractive like that?
Anorectics often have a distorted perception of their actual body size. Although experts still cannot account for this basic misrecognition, they do point out that the rigorous self-discipline imposed by the anorectic is often the cause of an extreme exhilaration or high, which accompanies and rewards her denial of food.
Such feelings coming over me. There is wonder in most everything I see. Not a cloud in the sky, got the sun in my eyes, and I won't be surprised if it's a dream. Everything I want the world to be is now coming true, especially for me. And the reason is clear, it's because you are here. You're the nearest thing to heaven that I've seen. I'm on the top of the world looking down on creation, and the only explanation I can find is the love that I've found ever since you've been around. Your love's put me at the top.
Okay.
Oh, ridiculous, Karen.
Hey, if I don't say so myself, I think we both look pretty good up there.
Yeah.
But who was that
sexy chick at the microphone.
Oh, yeah, right. Now, you kids are getting big, all right, but you're not going to get big-headed. Not if I can help it.
Come on, we were just kidding.
Let me finish. Now, your father and I have been talking, and we feel that no matter how famous you get, you're both to continue living at home to avoid as much of that life as possible. I don't have to go into our policy on drugs. It remains the same. But we feel that in addition to this, you might start thinking about something charitable to do with your money. Sensible investment of some kind. Maybe even something for the Downey community.
That's a great suggestion, Ma. And it's very keeping with our image.
Hello? Oh, hello, Jack. Yes, we're all here. From who? You're kidding. No. This weekend? Oh, my goodness.
What is it, Agnes?
The president has requested you to sing at the White House brunch this weekend.
Sing a song. Sing out loud. Sing out strong.
Carpenters come out of the Burt Bacharach, Herb Alpert sound of the 60s. But their music was even cleaner, more purified. There was just something about Karen Carpenter's voice that you couldn't dismiss. I mean, here was this corny teenage girl with bangs singing these songs with that deep, sort of sophisticated voice of hers.
For me, their sound was too smooth and manipulative, and their image was too clean and sweet. And so they epitomized for me the return to reactionary values in the 70s. And I never trusted them.
I think Karen Carpenter was a very underestimated performer. I mean, she was one of my main influences. Her vocal range, her phrasing, they were totally unique, totally different. The way she evoked a kind of irony in a song. I mean, just listen to Rainy Days and Mondays. No one was doing that at the time. She was totally unique. But instead, she became this kind of joke, this goody-goody girl. I feel like she never got the recognition that she deserved.
Well, I was just calling to ask you the very same question.
So where do you want to go?
Oh, not the source, please. Well, okay, I didn't know you cooked. Oh, well, I can help, sure. What time should I come by?
The Carpenter's latest call.
Okay, great, I'll see you at 5. Bye.
Radio.
Some sleepless night, if you should find yourself alone. Let me be the one you run to. Let me be the one you come to when you need someone to turn to. Let me be the one to set things right when this old world's turned upside down. Let me be the one.
How's your meat?
Fine. How's your salad?
Horrible. I can't eat it.
Send it back.
I'm not even hungry. So sick of road food.
Just 2 more months to go. We'll see.
I know. We'll be home for 2 weeks. It's just wearing on me.
Well, you don't take care of yourself, Ken. You don't eat. I really think this diet of yours is the problem. I mean, Karen, you look really thin.
I like the way I look.
Karen, you starve yourself. All you ever eat is salad and iced tea.
I really don't know why you're making such a big deal out of this.
Here, eat this. I just want to see you take a bite. Come on, Karen.
I don't want to. Just stop it.
Why? Why can't you take just even one bite?
Following World War II and the end of rationing in the early 50s, America was reacquainted with food as plentiful and cheap. There were vast changes in food delivery, availability, and storage. Refrigerators, already a part of the American kitchen, became commonplace and thus eliminated the need for daily shopping. The growth of supermarkets with their rows and rows of dairy products, canned goods, meats, condiments, bakery goods, vegetables, fruits and staples brought a large display of food into everybody's range. Few could leave the supermarket without buying more than they intended. And the kitchen, often the center of the home, contained an ever-expanding variety of foods. Home life in America connoted the cozy kitchen, food preparation, and mealtime.
Karen? Karen, we've got 15 minutes till the second show. Are you ready?
Karen? Karen, wake up! Come on! We've got 15 minutes till the... What are you doing with these?
Oh, God, I'm so sleepy.
How many laxatives did you take? What are you trying to do? Ruin both our careers? Jeez. Now get up. You drink some coffee. Now come on, we've got 15 minutes. Jeez, redo your makeup. You're a mess.
Quit. Nothing ever seems to fit. Hanging around, nothing to do but frown. Rainy days and Mondays always get me down. What I've got, they used to call me the blues. Nothing is really wrong. Like I don't belong. Walking around some kind of lonely clown. Rainy days and Mondays always get me down. Funny, but it seems I always wind up here with you. Nice to know somebody loves me. But it seems that it's the only thing to do. Run and find the one who loves me. What I feel. what's all about. Hanging around, nothing to do but crowd. Rainy days, Mondays always get me down.
She's coming too.
Karen?
Where am I? You're in the hospital, dear.
You collapsed on stage.
From exhaustion and malnutrition.
You'll be here 5 more days.
Then home for plenty of rest.
You're gonna be under Mom's constant care.
I'll cook for you.
She's gonna fatten you up.
No more dieting.
No more laxatives.
And we'll all be together again.
High failure rate in the treatment of anorexia. The refusal to eat is so annoying to doctors and family that intervention seems to focus entirely on trying to make the sufferer eat. When the anorectic is unable to comply with the dietary plan, she is often force-fed. In these cases, the patient is considered officially recovered when the normal weight is reached and appropriate sex role functioning achieved. Ultimately, treatments which assert absolute control over the patient's life only contribute to anorectic behavior, which is often the result of highly controlled familial environments.
Oh, my
what a
goodness.
Beautiful table.
Karen,
how
well
cooked. Listen, I have a toast to make. To Karen, whose public is eagerly awaiting her return.
Oh, dear Karen. Thank you. And what do you say, Richard? We have a surprise for Mom and Dad.
Oh. Do you think it now's the time?
Well, sure. We're celebrating.
Okay.
Mom, Dad, seeing as I'm turning 25 soon, and Richard was 25 when he moved out, we thought this was the year for me to try it.
Your brother was 26.
Mom, listen, we found the most beautiful condo in Century City.
Century City? Out of the question.
Mother, wait.
I will not allow Karen to move to some apartment an hour away from here after what just happened to her. Why can't she find a nice place in Downey? Why does she have to be out in the middle of...
Because she doesn't want to live in Downey, all right?
Glad you could come. I wouldn't have missed it. How are you feeling?
Really great. I'm so excited about the new place. Did you see the TV screen? It's 7 feet wide.
It's a beautiful apartment. I wish you all the luck.
Karen, I'd like you to meet a terrific guy. Terry Alice, this is my sister, Karen.
Nice to meet you. Come in, Richard. It's open.
Karen?
I'll be there in a sec.
Hey. You remember what happened the last time? Jack's made time to see us. Karen?
I'm ready. Let's go.
Karen? What are you doing with these?
I was constipated.
Oh, you liar!
Don't tell Mom and Dad, Richard.
Why shouldn't I? Why shouldn't I tell them? Do you know you are just ruining us?
If you do, I'll tell them about you and your private life.
Say one word to them. One fucking word, Karen.
They're gonna find out sooner or later.
You little bitch!
What's wrong? Do the Carpenters have something to hide?
kan en mag niet weigeren.
In the cold climate.
Greater war approached America.
Also, choose for only $9.97. Start your subscription.
Everything.
Well, we're going to be giving a...
UTV. Open.
Stage.
All you have to do is put yourself in my hands.
You have just been so fanatical about your way.
All you ever eat is salad and iced tea.
What are you trying to do? Ruin both our careers?
Nothing really but your head.
Carpenters
have something to hide.
Karen! Come back here, young lady! Karen!
Karen?
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 Maison tonight. Some very special people will be there, and I don't want to hear you tell me that you're not up for it. This is an important dinner, and you're going to be there. I'll pick you up at 6:30 and wear something loose-fitting.
Oh, shit.
We're over here.
You didn't tell me that Richard was coming.
That isn't Richard. Karen, may I introduce you to...
Karen, pleasure to meet you. Tom Burris, good friend of Jack's.
Hello.
Pardon my enthusiasm. I've just always loved your singing.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thoughts of leaving disappear each time I see your eyes. And no matter how hard I try to understand the reason why we carry on this way, we're lost in a masquerade.
It's been tough times with the divorce, Karen. And I know that you're under tremendous pressure. We have obligations. We have contracts that we have to fulfill. We are still catching up from the setback that you had 6 years ago. Karen, people are talking about you. Your fans are worried. I can hear them gasping when we walk on stage. Now, what the hell are we supposed to do about that?
Richard! I know. I know I'm sick. I know something's wrong. And I need help.
What do you mean, sick? mentally?
Richard, have you ever heard the word anorexia?
Of course, I've heard people call you that.
Richard, I am that. And I guess I'm just beginning to realize that it isn't something good.
Is this Jerry Ben O'Neill?
Yes, who's calling?
Jerry, this is Karen Carpenter. I don't think we've ever met, but someone mentioned your name to me. I was told you were writing a book about,
my anorexia. Yes. Karen, if that's why you're calling, please don't be ashamed to talk. Believe me, I've been through the worst of it and recovered.
Yes. Yes, it's what I need. I've got to get over this. It's just messing up everything. You have no idea the kind of pressure I'm under. I've just got to get well.
Karen, there's no such thing as a quick fix with this. Sometimes it can't be cured at all. But it's always a long, hard battle.
How long?
3 years, minimum.
3 years? That's out of the question.
Karen, listen to me. If you really want to shake this thing, you'll have to put everything else aside for as long as it takes. Since my recovery, I've been working very closely with my doctor, assisting other anorectics. And I couldn't recommend him strongly enough.
What's his name?
Dr. Stephen Levenkron. His treatment is in New York. But believe me, it's more than essential to undergo treatment away from the pressures of
home, family, and career. So that's what I'm going to do.
Alone?
New York? For how long?
Now look, I know that you're all concerned and won't like being excluded from my recovery, but Cherry couldn't stress enough how much family life and career add to the stress of anorexia. Cherry also came from a tight-knit family.
Now who is this Cherry person? Where did you find her?
Cherry is Pat Boone's oldest daughter who recovered from anorexia.
What do you mean by family pressure?
You should go with her, Agnes, to check out this Levenkron character.
No. No one is to come with me. I've got to do this alone. I have to.
The two of us, strangers in many ways. We've got a lifetime to share, so much to say. And as we go from day to day, I'll feel you close to me.
Notice how she cleaned her plate.
Mother, didn't you know there are children starving in Africa?
But it's true. It's true, and she's even back to her old favorites now. Chili and tacos.
And that three-course meal at St. Germain's after the Grammy reunion.
You haven't lost a pound.
Or gained. 108.
108.
Now, Karen, don't you touch those dishes. Your father and I will do them. You kids run along. You know you have an early session.
All right, thanks a lot, Mom.
Mom. Thanks, Dad. Levenkron. No, I just got home this second. A what? Oh, doing great. Feels super. Better than ever. Yeah, I know. I'm sorry. I've just been so busy lately.
Well, we're recording a new album.
Oh, I know it's soon, but yes, I've stayed right at 108 and I'm eating well.
Nope, I haven't touched an X-Lax or even thought of it.
I just feel more in control than ever.
Well, you know what I mean. And all thanks to you.
Well, thank you for calling. I promise to call soon, yes.
Yeah, thanks again. Bye.
Every time I walk
Once upon a time, there was a little girl named Dorothy who lived on a hideous farm in Kansas with her Aunt Em and her smelly old Uncle Henry. One day, Dorothy ran home from school screaming her head off.
Aunt Em! Aunt Em! Miss Gulch had taught her with the rake, and now she's gonna get the sheriff to take him away, and I just...
Aunt Em slapped her across the face.
How?
You're hysterical. Go find yourself a place where you won't get into any trouble.
A place where there isn't any trouble. Do you suppose there is such a place, Toto? It's not a place you can get to by a boat or a train. It's far away, behind the moon, beyond the rain.
Somewhere over the rainbow. God, I hate that song. Let's skip to the good part, shall we? Suddenly, Miss Gulch pedaled up to the dreary little farmhouse on her bicycle. Mr. Gale, I want to see you and your wife right away about Dorothy.
Henry, Emily, I had so hoped that the day would not come when I would have to deliver such unhappy news. But indeed, I am so shaken by the ferocious attack of your niece's vicious dog that I may never walk again. And so, as an act of public service, I'm taking him to the sheriff and make sure he's destroyed.
That dog's a menace to the community. If you don't hand him over, I'll bring a damage suit that'll take your whole farm. Here's the order. Allow me to take him. Unless you want to go against the law. Just put him in this basket so I can have him put to sleep so he can't attack me again. After all, there's a law protecting folks against dogs that bite. A law! And with that, she slammed the basket shut and sped away on her bicycle. Dorothy cried and cried. Unfortunately, the little rat managed to escape, and Dorothy decided it would be best if she and Toto ran away from home just as a giant twister was drifting towards a ramshackle little farm. Dorothy screamed and screamed for help, but she was miles from where anyone could hear her. Then the great cyclone lifted the tiny house higher and higher into an endless black sky and delivered it to the land of Oz, where it landed with a great thump. When she stepped outside the house, of which there was very nearly nothing left, she found herself in a land that was very beautiful and very colorful, and the brightest color of all was the shiny red color on the shoes of some poor innocent person that her house had killed. And since no one was looking, Dorothy decided to take the shoes for her trouble. Ah, this thing just sort of rambles on and on and on. Glinda. The munchkins. Aha, the witch! And when the wicked witch saw the ruby slippers on Dorothy's feet, she screamed with rage! No. She was cool as a cucumber. New shoes? Sure are pretty. Pretty enough to kill for. I bet you's just getting ready to go tippy-tapping down the yellow brick road to break 'em in. They all took everything away from me, but not this time. If you were in my neighborhood, lady, I could kick your ass right now. But since Miss Bubble is here, I guess I'll have to wait. In the meantime, take good care of those little loafers, because I'm gonna be riding your butt all the way to Emerald City just to make sure you don't scuff them up, see? So fasten your seatbelt, baby. Hit the road, Jack, before somebody drops a house on you, too. Well, Dorothy reckoned that she better go back to Kansas. Meanwhile, back at the witch's castle, the witch was consulting with her minister of defense, the leader of the flying monkeys.
Ah,
I must get those shoes.
What would you do with the shoes if you had them? Asked the monkey.
Why, if I had those shoes, I would. I would get that little pretty, destroy the Emerald City, and flatten Toto too. Then the wizard I would slaughter, and I'd dry up all the water if I only had the shoes. Oh, I'd threaten that I'd hover, and folks would duck and cover, and mind your P's and Q's. I would do my doom and gloom shtick as I zoom quick on my broomstick if I only had the shoes. Oh, I'd be flying high, my feet a-twinkling red. I would fill the folks in Munchkin Land with dread. And then I'd click, and they'd be dead, they'd be dead. Oh, I'd make that girl surrender, to hell is where I'd send her, a victory I could use. I'd be causing lots of trouble, and I'd blow up Glinda's bubble, if I only had the shoes. If I only had the shoes. Oh, yeah. I know just the thing, attractive to the eye, soothing to the smell. Happy, happy, sleep, sleep, sleep.
But Glinda was watching over Dorothy and ruined the whole damn spell. The witch watched in her crystal ball, she began to experience feelings of failure and despair. Feelings that were very familiar to a hard-working witch who had spent her life trying to measure up to her older sister, only to be ignored by her mother and father.
Even my broomstick is a hand-me-down. And I always felt if I could only get my hands on those shoes, things would somehow be different, that I would be somebody.
It's not that easy being green, having to spend each day the color of the leaves, when I think it might be nicer being yellow or gold or red like those shoes, or something much more colorful like that. It's not easy being green. It seems you blend in with so many other ordinary things, and people tend to pass you over, 'cause you're not standing out like flashy sparkles on the water or stars in the sky. But green is the color of spring and money, and green can be cool and friendly like money. And green can be big like an ocean, or important like a mountain, or tall like a tree. When green is all there is to be, it could make you wonder why, but why wonder why I'm green? And it'll do.
Yeah.
It's beautiful, and I think it's what I want to be. Green.
Yes, yes, that's it. I have the power to change my own destiny. I am strong, I am invincible. I am witch, hear me roar.
Curtain up, light the light. I've got nothing to hit but the heights.
It's time I grew up and stopped carrying around grudges that are running my life and making me miserable. Mother and father, I forgive you. Sister, I forgive you. And Dorothy?
You're dead.
I mean, I forgive you.
And suddenly the witch felt a huge burden being lifted from her shoulders. And the sun shone through her castle windows for the first time in years. And the witch looked down at her feet and found the ruby slippers glistening in the sun. She felt complete and whole for the first time in her life and decided to pursue her ultimate dream. So she clicked her heels together three times and said over and over, "There's no place like Vegas. There's no place like Vegas. There's no place like Vegas!" The Las Vegas Hilton is proud to present the biggest star on the strip. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a rousing welcome to the Wicked Witch of the West!
Magic has you in its spell. That old black magic that I weave so well. Those icy fingers up and down your spine. That same old witchcraft where your eyes meet mine. That same old tingle that I feel inside. And when that magic broomstick starts its ride, then darling, down you go, round and round you go, in a spin, loving the spin we're in, under that old black magic called love. I'm wild again, beguiled again, a simpering, whimpering child. Again, bewitched, bothered, and bewildered am I. I'm flying. Hey, look at me way up high, and what's more, I'm not even trying. 'Cause it's witchcraft, wicked witchcraft. And although I know it's strictly taboo, when you arouse the need in me, my heart says yes indeed in me. I got to be what I gotta be. Whoa, such an ancient pitch, but one that you'll never switch. 'Cause there's no better witch than me. Bewitched, bothered, and bewildered by that old black magic. That old it's witchcraft.
Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you. Oh, oh,
oh. I must have been dreaming. I dreamed that a hideous little girl from the Midwest killed my sister and stole her valuable shoes. And all I kept saying to everybody was, I've got to get those shoes. And I got the shoes. But anyway, I'm home at last. Back to what I know and love. Being a Keno girl at Valley's.
And if she ever went looking for her heart's desire, she didn't look any further than the Tropicana. Because if it isn't there, she never really lost it to begin with. And oh, Auntie M, there's no place like Vegas.